All right, so Google finally updated and launched their asynchronous AI coding agent, Jules. And you can see as of 4 days ago, it's officially out of beta and launching publicly. It's now powered by Gemini 2.5 Pro, which is really good at coding if you've used it before in places like Cursor. And with Google AI Pro, which is their all-in-one subscription AI plan, you get 5x higher limits. And with Google AI Ultra, you get 20x higher limits. So you can check it out on this page. We'll be trying it out on a real-world production codebase. It can integrate with GitHub. It can see your repos, branch changes, and help you create a PR. It uses a virtual machine, like it clones your code and it verifies that it works. It has a test suite as well, as it can run existing tests or create new ones. And it also shows its work, its plan, and so forth. And basically, since it's asynchronous, it runs in the background, kind of like how Cursor background agents do. Anyways, I'll be trying it out on a real-world production codebase, which is my app, Tenza AI. And this basically helps you stay up to date with the latest AI news. You can download it for Android or iOS using the link in the description down below. And basically, you can see right now, like, this is all the AI news that's happened today. You can listen to a summary and so forth. And I recently translated the app into Japanese because there was quite a bit of demand from Japan. So what I want to do with Jules is I want to translate the landing page for the app into Japanese, and then I'm going to have it do some more complicated tasks, like adding RSS feeds and so forth. So basically, starting out, we're going to go to Jules over here, press Try Jules, and then I'm going to link it to my GitHub. So I'm going to connect it to my GitHub account. And now I selected the relevant repo. So I'm going to start out with a simple task. Hey, basically, can you install Next.i18 Next for the Next.js application and update the landing page to be in Japanese as well? Make a file with the translation keys in English and Japanese, auto the text of the language that the user is using, and show the relevant landing page. And then I can either press Create Plan over here or press Start Interactive Plan so I can deeply understand the goals before actually generating a plan. So I'm going to just press Create Plan because this is a pretty simple task. It should be fine here. And whilst we're waiting for it, I'm kind of wondering, because Google also released a Gemini CLI, how this compares to Gemini CLI. Of course, this runs asynchronously in the background, and it's using the same model as well. But I wonder if the system prompt or instructions or just anything else is slightly different from this, or even if the teams behind both of these products are working together in some way. It would be quite nice if in Gemini CLI, you were able to fire off this into the background in Jules, for example, for simpler tasks. But anyway, it seems the plan is now done, and it auto-approves if you don't approve it manually over here. Let me just quickly read through this. And yeah, this is basically what I would have done as well, so I'm going to press Approve Plan over here. But I guess one big difference between Jules and Gemini CLI is that with Gemini CLI, you have to pay for the Gemini like CLI separately as a separate subscription. So if you go to your Google Cloud Console, then you'll choose it from over here. And then I think the cost per license is $22.80 per month over here. But of course, the Gemini CLI does have a generous free tier as well. But the thing with Jules is that if you have the Google AI or Google AI Pro subscription over here, which I currently have, or the Google AI Ultra subscription, then you can use Jules with higher limits as well. But the nice thing is that you can use both of them for free, and you can try out both of them for free as well. And the nice thing is that whilst it's running, you can see the changes that it's making. So in the package.json file, it installed these two dependencies. It also made this brand new file over here. And yeah, it's quite nice that you can monitor the progress like this. All right, you can see it's running into an error where it's trying to run npm run dev, but since it doesn't have a .env file, it can't run it. So I told it to suggest domain environment variables, and for some reason it can't do that. So I'm just going to say finalize it, you're done, because it seems to have generated all the files that are required for this. But it's slightly odd because there's a system thing that prevents it from being able to verify its work because it can't create a .env file. So maybe as part of your codebase, you need a .env.example file when you're like publishing it to GitHub. But yeah, that's the kind of a thing that you just need to do, it seems. And now you can see that once it's ready, you can actually press a button over here, see all the proposed changes that it has in the same file structure that your project is in. And then you can press publish branch. So it made a brand new branch. And then you can also press publish branch and generate PR. So I'm going to press this, publish branch, generate PR. And then if I go to my GitHub, I should see the PR over here from Google Labs Jules. And then I can press merge pull request. And that should then update the landing page on production after it finishes deploying on Vercel. Anyways, it seems to have worked because I merged the PR request into the main branch, had it deployed in Vercel. And then I loaded it up on my phone, which is set in Japanese. And you can see it works completely fine. And meanwhile, my computer is set in English. So it works fine in English as well over here, the landing page. So that was a very simple task. We're going to give it something more complicated. And basically, in the admin panel of the website, what I do have is a Twitter list. So these all are all the AI accounts that it's monitoring, and whenever there's new news on any of these Twitter accounts, it automatically creates a new post on the application for these Twitter accounts. So actually what's happening behind the scenes of the application is that all of these posts came from one of these Twitter accounts over here. Now this is valuable because like you get the latest news from the Twitter accounts, but I also want it to handle RSS feeds for particular websites. So for example, the official Google blog have their own RSS feed over here. And I want like a list of me being able to add RSS feeds to application and for it to like then scrape RSS feeds and find any new information and then create a post out of it. So that's slightly more complicated. So we'll see how it performs because it requires a database migration. It requires some UI changes. It requires a somewhat big rewrite of some background functions. But yeah, let's see how that performs. And this time I'm going to say start interactive plan. Press interactive plan over here. And now I think it's going to look carefully through the code base and find anything that it needs clarifying questions on, and then use that. And now you can see after looking through the code base, it asked me some clarifying questions. So I'm just going to answer these. All right, so I just came back from lunch and I just checked over the code and it looks pretty good. It did make a small error where it didn't edit the declarative schema that I did say, but that is a rule in my cursor rules and also my claude.md file, which I use with Claude Code. And it would be quite nice if Jules also followed the rules in those folders or files as well, because nowadays it's getting pretty annoying with having a separate like rules folder or agent.md folder or claude.md folder for every single agent that there is coding agent wise. Anyway, we're gonna test out the solution because whilst it does look good on the surface, there may be a small mistake that I just can't see. So I'll press publish PR over here, and then I will switch to the RSS monitoring branch over here. So you can see over here my claude.md file. I wish it followed this flow for being able to generate migrations by first editing the schema and then actually making the migration. But it seems it would have to install the Superbase CLI or something like that, which I'm not sure it is able to do. And when running the function, it does seem to be working. So it fetches all the links from the RSS feed and then it starts scraping the links for the content. And if I go to my link fetch, it is actually fetching the links and storing the information in the database. And then that will be aggregated and put into like AI news. So overall, I think it did a pretty good job. When reading through the code over here, I was quite surprised because it also added comments such as it added over here, this step is no longer required as recent links contains all necessary data, rather than removing it completely. And I think that's quite nice because when you're checking through the code, like sometimes you forget the logic and it explains it for you in this case, especially when removing things. The only real issue is it did not use any of my claude.md files or cursor rules files to figure out how to make migrations and use the migration workflow. And it also did miss a closing tag for one of the divs, which I showed earlier. But overall, it did a pretty good job, and it's nice to see that's bundled with the Google AI Pro plan and Google AI Ultra plan. So if you're already using one of these, you don't need to get another plan, which is quite nice. I know the plans are really racking up nowadays because people are paying for like Cursor, Claude Code, ChatGPT, which includes Codex as well, Google AI plan as well. And there are so many plans these days, so it's nice to see this is kind of bundled with the existing plan. And also because you're not paying on a token basis, I think it may be cheap in many cases. I think this is suited towards much smaller tasks, but it did do quite well in a bigger task as well. It did have a really good understanding of the code base and knowing where certain things are. I found that to be the case with Gemini CLI as well. I think Gemini 2.5 Pro, which both of them are using, just has a good understanding of the code base overall. I think my personal use case for this would be I wouldn't make any new features with this. I think that can be quite difficult. I don't really like making new features in the background either. I'm probably gonna use this for like adding on to existing features, which are already well established, or doing quick bug fixes. And one of the nice things about it is that it's responsive on mobile. So you can click on any of the chats on mobile over here, and then you can also see the like chat itself and also the code, and then create the PR for mobile. So you can monitor how things are going on the go, or you can just make a new session on the go and then come back to it later on. So I'm actually going to see the new Jurassic Park, Jurassic World movie with a friend, and I might actually be using this in the cinema during any boring scenes, just setting off new tasks for simple fixes, and also doing bug fixes on the go. For example, someone sent me an email saying that the upload failed when it came to updating their profile picture, so I could just take this error message, then give it to Jules on my phone, and then come back later on my computer, and it should be fixed. I will be using it more over the coming days, and if there's anything worth sharing, then I will make a new video about it. But if there isn't a whole lot worth sharing, then I'll just leave a comment down below, and you can check out that comment, which should be pinned somewhere. Anyways, if you have enjoyed the video, then do subscribe because it's good feedback for the algorithm that this video is good. And if you have tried this out, then do leave a comment down below sharing your thoughts because I'm interested in what other people are thinking and how they're finding this tool as well.